Another way to think about macroevolution is in the distribution and the relationships of species on a very grand geographic scale, representing changes over huge geological time spans. And we find that macroevolutionary patterns show fundamental similarities with microevolution. We see in many, many cases that there will have been directional selection that have led to large-scale adaptations. We also can take the principles of island speciation, where you get the adaptive radiations on archipelagos, on small trends within, say, the Darwin's finches or the cichlid fishes. And we can expand that out to a worldwide scale. So remember that at one stage, all the continents on Earth were connected. They began to break up about 202 million years ago, so this was Pangaea. Then we have Europe and Asia separating off from Africa and South America. And as these continents split up, and then Africa splitting off from South America, it was no longer possible for species to move from one continent to the next. If we have the kinds of processes we saw in terms of speciation with island speciation, and those can happen over a few million years, these are now over tens and hundreds of millions of years. And if we extend the kinds of directional selection that we've seen before over these long time spans, we start seeing things that are very, very striking at a macroevolutionary scale. Today, there are two fairly diverse groups of mammals. There are the placentals, like us. So the baby is attached to the mother's womb by a placenta, versus the marsupials, which are like kangaroos, and the baby is born very premature and spends a lot of its time in the mother's pouch. And in Australia, which has been separated from the rest of the world for quite a long period of time, there are macroevolutionary patterns in the marsupials that all have a common ancestor that parallel strikingly species that we see that have placentas that stayed in the rest of the world after the split from Australia. And so there is a Tasmanian wolf that runs like a wolf, has sharp teeth like a wolf. In many ways, it is a wolf, but it's not a wolf. It's a possum. It's a kangaroo. It has a pouch. And then looking extraordinarily different, very, very different characteristics, a cat-like possum. It's a marsupial. And a possum-like anteater, and a possum-like flying squirrel. Very, very different shapes that have all arisen within this one lineage after this long-term separation between the placentals and the marsupials. So it's not just getting variations on the theme of Darwin's finches with slightly larger beaks. You're getting something as profoundly different as a wolf versus a squirrel within related lineages, because there was the similar opportunities and a long, long time for this diversification to take place. So we have adaptive radiations where we have similar selection pressures leading to very similar forms, even in very distantly related taxa. Wolf that's a possum versus one that's not, a mouse that's a possum versus one that's not. Now, often in thinking about long-term evolutionary trends, it's very common for people to assume that there's something that we can still get from dear old Aristotle's scale of nature, that surely organisms are always striving to evolve in some way, that they move up this great chain of being through a continuous striving of perfection in Aristotle's terms, which we know is wrong. And we also know, given the facts about evolution and the facts about the distribution and types of species around the world, that evolutionary change, while often quite dramatic and profound, is not inevitable. Species are not always expected to change. Directional selection may lead to a whole new form. It may cause the bones in the jaw eventually to become bones in the inner ear. But there are many circumstances where we expect some form of stabilizing selection. And if the norm is favored by natural selection, there's no reason for a species to change. So stabilizing selection can favor very long periods of phenotypic stability, no evolutionary change at all. And bacteria provide a really fantastic example of this. They're the oldest living organisms on Earth. They've been around since the first life on the planet. And today, bacteria form colonies that can merge into these things called stromatolites. This is on the beach in Australia. Well, a billion years ago, there were these same circumstances in what's now northern Minnesota. The form is essentially the same after billions and billions of years. Bacterial cells have always been about the same size. Individual bacteria are very tiny, and they've been very, very tiny for a billion years. There's been no trend for the bacteria to go the way of the dinosaurs and become very much larger or very much smaller. That's not necessarily because they can't grow larger. It's just that circumstances haven't favored them to grow larger. This graph just shows that you, if you want, you can subject a bacterial lineage in a flask to selection where you only allow the largest individual bacteria in a flask to reproduce, and you select for larger and larger cells, and they will get bigger if you select for it. So they are capable of growing larger, but they haven't needed to. There's been no reason for bacteria to get any larger than the typical size of a bacteria that it's been for the last billion years. If we look at a species like the coelacanth, which we've seen already, is an animal that has not shown much speciation. It's a very conservative animal, okay? They're pretty much unchanged for the last 400 odd million years. They're 5 feet long, they weigh about 200 pounds, they always have. They live in a deep ocean. They live in a constant environment. Under these circumstances, there hasn't been any pressure for them to change. So there may just be one best way to be a coelacanth. Evolution has been the hallmark of life on Earth to give rise to extraordinary adaptations like eyes and wings. But unless there's a selective pressure to change, it's not inevitable.